Hi, my name is Francesca Dominici. I'm a professor of biostatistics at the Harvard T.H. School of Public Health and co-director of the Harvard Data Science Initiative and the principal investigator of the study on air pollution and mortality that we'll be talking today. So this was a study where we gathered a massive amount of data. Actually, we gathered health information for almost 97% of the population in the United States older than 65 and linked with their exposure to air pollution for the last 12 years. This was a massive data intensive study. And I am here to have a conversation with Chandi, who is a doctoral student in the Department of Environmental Health and the lead author of the study. And I will be asking him some questions, some behind the scene question about how we made this work. So Chandi, so first question is, we have been working together with many of our colleagues, actually not only at the school, but all around the university, to bring together this enormous data, what we call a data science research platform. Can you tell us very briefly about what type of data and how big the data?
Yes, so we spent years of efforts trying to build this data science research platform that integrating data from different sources, like satellite data, like meteorological data, like land use data, and the US census data, many data. Most importantly, we integrate all different sources into a uniform data framework. And because the data source unit, the multiple data sources, so the data size unit huge, terabyte of data.
So considering this massive amount of data, right, that we have been pulling together for all types of data source, you couldn't run it on your computer. So tell us how you were able to rely on Harvard expertise to be able to analyze this massive amount of data.
Yeah, as you said, we cannot use our laptop to know the data, otherwise we are killing our laptop. So that's why I really appreciate the help from Odyssey Group and the research computer environment to provide us the state-of-the-art computational resources. We can leverage a large chunk of memory and CPU there.
Yeah, so there are one of the largest supercomputing at Harvard, you briefly mentioned, is called Odyssey, which is part of the research computing at the School of Art and Science. And that is a shared resource. So that means the multiple students and faculty can use the same. Yeah. So how did you, tell us a little bit how you strategize with your colleagues to take to be able to rely on the maximum amount of computing power that were available?
Yeah, as you said, it's shared resources. We need to wait for the memory and disk. And so Christine Chorite, who is a professional data scientist in our team, and she and I are working on the computational issues. And we choose some time when nobody else was using the cluster, which is the Christmas Eve, and we stay until 12 o'clock until night to submit all our jobs there. So that's how we can make the best use of the computational resources.
That's great. And so another question is, we talked about we talk about massive amount of data and we talk about the importance of relying on the best of Harvard to access research computing. But data research computing are not the only two ingredients, I think the two key aspects to be able to make reliable conclusion from analysis of data. And so another important element is what we call data science methods, right? Can you very briefly talk about what are these and why this is was so important?
Yeah, so that's a good question. So for data science, data is important. Computational resource is important. The key thing is data science methodology. For myself, I learned some statistical course from our school, and then I took some machine learning course from the main campus provided by Dr. David Parks. So because I feel like statistical method and data science approach like machine learning, they're complementary. And we should know both of them to know under what condition we should use statistics. under what condition we should use machine learning and in what condition we should combine them together.
Yeah.
So my point is, methodology is a key, and that's a key for all the doctor students.
Yeah, and so finally, you know, one element that I think I would like for you to comment about is that in the presence of this enormous data, how we do the analysis, especially when we are making conclusion that could potentially have an important policy impact. The open source aspect of the analysis and the reproducibility in the data is, you know, it's important. So how you together with Christine Charette, which is a professional data scientist, went along in terms of making sure that the results will be reproducible and trustworthy?
Yeah, Christine and I and my advisor, Dr. Schwartz, are working together. So actually, all the data we use to make the air pollution come from open source. We got all the data from either from NASA, from Environmental Protection Agency, from the US Census, and from some other website. All of their data is publicly available. It's open source. You can download for free. And as a researcher, I really appreciate they can provide the data for our researchers. And also for the follow-up health study, we got the data from the Center for Medicare and Medicaid. So that's Medicare data. It's government data, and everyone can get it. So in principle, the air pollution prediction model and the follow-up health study, they're in principle reproducible.